Thanks a lot for attending. So today I'm going to be talking about my package called EpiModel in R for mathematical modeling of infectious diseases over contact networks. So I'll just jump right in. What is EpiModel? Well, it's an R package, which is why I'm here. It's part of the StatNet suite of packages in R that handle different aspects of statistical analysis, simulation, and visualization of network data within R. It's open source software, given that it's in R, specifically for epidemic modeling, and contains some various tools for modeling across different classes. The novel part of the software is modeling over networks, and so I'm just going to be focusing my talk today on that. So just as a motivation of why we should care about networks for infectious diseases, typically within infectious disease data, we're looking at people's in terms of their individual level of exposure risk, where we might measure, say, the number of partners that they currently have or aspects that put them at risk for infections, such as immunological factors. But we need to zoom out within an infectious disease context to understand how the partners of partners, the connections of connections, the contacts of contacts, put people at risk outside of that specific individual level context. So we might have two people who have one current partner, but person one is at risk of infection, not as a function of his or her own behavior, but as a function of his partner's behavior. And is embedded within a riskier part of the network. Zooming out a little bit, even small changes of that individual level behavior can have large implications for the connectivity of the network. So even minor changes going from the left to the right of the number of current sexual partners that one might have increases the connectivity of the network and essentially is a vehicle for the spread of different diseases. So Sebastian talked about this a little bit already, but just to motivate this, in contrast to empirical study designs where we're simply working from a statistical analysis of the data, mathematical modeling of infectious diseases is kind of flipping the process on its head to abstract an infectious disease into a general system in which the infectious disease dynamics are built or simulated from the ground up. To help us understand the data generating mechanism. So we often project up to the population level and forward in time. Those are typically of interest, and these methods allow us to handle the complex dependencies that are inherent in the contagion effects of disease dynamics in which the current risk of infection for an individual is a function of the disease prevalence in the community, and those things change over time. So the prevailing method for handling this in the field has been deterministic compartmental models or ordinary differential equation models. But for HIV and other sexually transmitted infections, these have some key limitations in handling some of the important processes that we're interested in understanding the disease dynamics about. Number one is that we typically want to be building out models that are replicating key aspects of realistic populations, and that involves stratifying the population based on a number of attributes in terms of demographics, risks, and other factors. Compartmental models, every time you're adding one new attribute of the population, involves a multiplication of the size of this system. And number two, and perhaps more importantly, is the way that partnerships are handled within these compartmental models is to use a funny bit of math, which instead of having a repeated contact where each contact might be a sexual act with the same person over time, and things could happen between those individual contacts with the same person, typically the implementation within compartmental models is to squish all of those acts down to a single point in time at which the force of infection or the risk is evaluated. So that's a limiting factor for understanding realistic sexual networks. So network models, in contrast, are those in which the repeated contacts with the same person over time are explicitly represented. They can be either static in the sense that the edges or the links between people are preserved over the course of the disease simulation, which are typically used for short-acting infections like, acute immunizing infections like viral infections, or they're potentially changing over time as the partnerships are forming and breaking. So it looks something like on the bottom there. Most of the networks, in contrast to the compartmental framework, are coded and simulated on an individual level, in which we're making up the population as on a person-by-person basis. So our methods use a form of statistical framework called exponential random graph models, or ERGMs, in order to represent the generative properties of what forms the composition of the network. You can think of an ERGM as a fancy logistic regression model in which what's on the left-hand side is the structure of the network as the Y, and what's on the right-hand side is an exponential function of a number of different criteria or variables that we want to put into the model that predicts whether edges or partnerships or links are going to exist or not. So can we observe the Y on the left-hand side? That's typically very challenging within a population-based setting. It's been attempted in at least two ways. Often people talk about, specifically for HIV and other viral infections, a phylogeny to characterize an infectious disease network. That's similar, but it's not quite what we're after, because we're interested in both the infected people and the uninfected people within the network, and a phylogeny only contains the infecteds. There have been some attempts to capture an overall census of a network, say, at a snapshot in time, the structure of sexual or social contacts within everybody within the population. This has been attempted in settings such as Lacoma Island in Malawi, but even there, the linchpin, one of the limitations in the methods was a huge amount of missing data, because you can't talk to everybody, and people may not be matching up correctly. So the census is really limited by the presence of missing data, and missing data specifically on edges or the partnerships is very problematic within the network statistical methods. Say if we there's a true connection between the orange nodes that's indirect through A, but we don't happen to observe A, or we don't observe the edges between A within our sample, then we won't be able to infer that indirect association. There are different forms of adaptive sampling then that try to get us there without needing to talk to everybody within this population and capture all of their edges or all of their contacts, and it's getting part of the way there. The method that we use is called egocentric sampling, in which we can go out into the population, take a sample of that population, ask them about their most recent contacts, and infer the complete network structure from there. So some of the things that we might ask people about or get data on an ego by ego level, and things that we put within the network model include these factors. So we might want to know the individual's degrees, such as the number of ongoing sexual partners that they have at a particular moment in time, or some arbitrary set of relationships between attributes of the person and attributes of their partners, such as age, or race, or sex of the partners. So all of these things can be put into one model, where what we're trying to simulate or estimate at the outset, at the end stage of the model, is the composition of the sexual network and how it looks. And finally, we need to add time to this process, in which we're not just interested in a cross-sectional structure or configuration of the network, but how it evolves over time. So that essentially involves conducting two ERGMs simultaneously, time step by time step. So one for edge formation and one for edge dissolution. So the edge formation is conditional on an edge not currently existing between two people, and a new edge, probabilistically forming, and the edge dissolution is an edge currently exists between two people, and the we're predicting that it's going to dissolve. The statistical methods for all of these have been developed over the past 15 years by my StatNet collaborators, and the methods are listed here in this paper. So again, this is a big project that's been conducted within the R language, within the R software platform. And the epi model is working just at the tippy top branches of this tree, where the other packages within the StatNet family are handling things like the representation of the network structure, doing the statistical analysis and simulation of the network, and other related utility features. So epi model is at the top of this tree. By taking all of the statistical framework and implementation of these R packages and just adding the epidemic simulation as an agent-based model on top of it. So everything that's complicated has been handled, you know, by behind the scenes by the StatNet group over the past decade, and we're just adding these this implementation of this contagion or infectious disease process on top of it. So we can start simple. And have a simple infectious disease system. And within epi model, our package contains base models in which you can define any sort of arbitrarily constructed network and what predicts partnership formation or edge formation between people, and then have a fixed agent-based model that has a particular structure. Or we can start to extend it. And so we built a general application programming interface or API, so you can, as a person interested, in a new infectious disease or an infectious disease in another setting, insert individual modules within the epidemic simulation that handle different aspects of the process. And so this is what it would kind of look like under the hood within epi model, where we have this time loop within our simulation function, NetSim, and you can go in there and plug in different modules that are handling aspects of the process that are specific to your research question. What would be fixed probably across all settings would be that network resimulation. So you can replace things you need to replace and keep the ones that you want to keep. So this is what it might look like for the HIV or STI context. We have lots of individual modules that are handling everything from getting on treatment to changes in viral load and that influencing transmission risk and so on. But again, what's at the heart of the package and the heart of the methods is this dynamic network simulation that's user-controlled. So two applications quickly just to show you what we've been using these tools for. In my research group, the first application was modeling HIV transmission within heterosexual couples in sub-Saharan Africa to understand how different values of the network connectivity influence biomedical interventions such as medical male circumcision for men in these populations, where we found that the changes in the network connectivity actually can have pretty substantial reductions in the efficiency of some of these interventions. Application number two, again another HIV model, where we were looking to understand the implications of HIV pre-exposure prophylaxis, which is a daily antiretroviral pill that you can take as an uninfected person to reduce your risk of infection. For men who have sex with men in the United States, the CDC in the United States has indications of who should be taking this drug and the frequency for medication and dosage. We built a model to understand under different scenarios of scaling up the intervention, what are the potential impacts on population level disease transmission. So the networks weren't an outcome of this intervention, but they played a key role in the targeting of this medication. So here are some resources for our package. Everything is linked on the website that we've built for the software, epimodel.org. We have a methods paper in press at the Journal of Statistical Software that's hopefully published in the next couple months. We're on GitHub and CRAN. And we teach a summer course in Seattle every year, a week-long course that extends these methods for new students. So here are some future directions for the software to extend to other infectious diseases and handle other parts of the process that we're interested in. But most importantly, we have this infrastructure now to support students researchers and policymakers who are interested in using these tools. Just want to close by thanking my co-authors, Martina Morris and Steve Gaudreau, who've built all these tools, the larger StatNet development group, my research lab at Emory University, and all of our funders at the National Institutes of Health. Thank you.